organized by our department this evening. Our department organizes several seminars, workshops, and knowledge enhancement program for the benefit of our students. I take this opportunity to introduce our resource person of the day, Dr. M.V. Ramanamurthy. He is a director and scientist at National Center for Coastal Research, NCCR. He has a long list of achievements. He holds a doctorate in ocean engineering from IIT Madras and has also worked on projects such as beach restoration at Pondicherry and Cuddalore, Chennai flood warning system, and many more. He is also our distinguished visiting professor for a department sponsored by AICTE and INEE for the third consecutive year. Our department has also signed a memorandum of understanding with NCCR. Now, I request our head of the department, Dr. Vandana, to address the gathering and share a few words about the knowledge enhancement program. Ma'am.
Good evening. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Good evening to one and all gathered here virtually. I extend my warm welcome on behalf of KCG College of Technology and Department of Civil Engineering to my supervisor as well as resource person of today's knowledge enhancement lecture, Dr. M.V. Ramanamurthy sir. Welcome. And I also extend my welcome to my dear budding civil engineers, department alumni, faculty members and students from other institutions, and also to my dear faculty members. Let me say a few words about this knowledge enrichment lecture. Global climate change. Everybody would have come across this term, global climate change. As we all know, it has already had observable effects on our planet Earth. Glaciers have shrunk, ice on rivers and lakes is breaking up earlier, plants and animal ranges have shifted, and trees are flowering sooner. Hope all of us are experiencing all this in our day-to-day life. Effects that scientists had predicted in the past could result from global climate change are occurring now. To name a few, loss of sea ice, accelerated sea level rise, and longer and more intense heat waves. Scientists across the globe are confident that global temperatures will continue to rise for decades to come, largely because of the greenhouse gas produced by humans. I used to tell my students in the class, there is a large gap human being and being human. So except humans, none other species are affecting or polluting the environment like us. So it's time to rise up. Taken as a whole, the International Panel on Climate Change stated that the net damage costs of climate change are likely to be significant and it is going to increase over time. The effects of global climate change include more frequent wildfires, longer periods of drought in some areas, and an increase in the number, duration, and intensity of tropical storms. Some of you may be wondering, what is the role of civil engineer in shoreline management? Coastal engineering, like structural engineering, like transportation engineering, like environmental engineering, like water resources engineering, it is one of the branches of civil engineering which involves coastal geology and oceanography. So the task of coastal engineer or civil engineer include the protection and management of coastlines. We, the civil engineers or coastal engineers, will be playing a vital role for the stability and development of our coastal environment. So they will be controlling the erosion, and they will be placing, constructing, and monitoring the coastal structures, nourishment of beaches, and development and maintenance of ports, harbors, and related navigational facilities for our sake and also for the benefit of future generations. With this small short note, I once again welcome each one of you for the virtual knowledge enhancement lecture. Over to Geetanjali. Geetanjali?
Ma'am, now I request Dr. Ramanamurthy sir to start presenting the topic.
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Good evening to all students, Dr. Vandana, Ms. Anjali, and then students of KIG College of Engineering. So first of all, I would like to thank your college for sharing this knowledge on that, especially on the climate change. So before going for sharing my PowerPoint presentation, I think Dr. Vandana has already told why this climate change is very important, especially whether it can be students from the civil engineering or mechanical or electrical, whoever it may be. Future, we are going to face very tough situation because of this climate change. You might have seen recently the melting of ice in the Uttarakhand, and then how it has come and impacted downstream. And it is not a new to us. In Chennai, we had 2015 great floods, and then many of the areas got inundated. Same is case with Mumbai, Kerala, and many parts of the country. What is happening with this climate change is our total water mass will remain same, but the amount of intensity of the rainfall, everything is happening in the short duration. Suppose if you go back and study hydrology in the civil engineering, you may be knowing about that concept called intensity and duration curve. What do you mean by intensity and duration curve is, in how much of the duration this rainfall has occurred with what intensity. That makes a lot of difference in flooding and all related things. On the other side, we have already many developments along the land areas, which changes the land use and then morphology of the many of the land mass. That is also going to cause additional impact due to the climate change and related things. So I will go back to my presentation, but you can stop me intermediate because this subject is not straightforward to civil engineering, but some of the concept of civil engineering, what you will be using it for the, especially when it comes to the marine area. Since we are located on the coast, so you may have some understanding on that, but I will try to make it as simple as possible to understand about the coast and climate and then ocean related to that. And then I also would like to tell at this point further, there are a lot of opportunities for many of the students in future to work on climate change and disasters. So that is very important for you. Basically, this lecture, I will provide you a insight into what are all the areas which you can see in the future for your future revenue further. I will share my presentation now. Could you see the presentation?
Yet to see, sir. But we can see your screen, sir. Yeah, it's visible, sir.
Now it is visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So now I have put it in the full screen mode. Hope I think it is in the full screen mode.
Yes, sir.
So the outline of my presentation is like that. We talk a little bit about our coast, how it has formed, and then what are the benefits, especially who are all living along the coast area. Even though I talk about a little bit of coast, but I think you also need to relate such kind of information to the mainland, especially what we will be talking about is a little bit of geology of civil engineering. Then we try to understand the ocean and coast. Basically, there are various forcing functions in the ocean. One is called as a wave. When you go to the beach, you may be seeing that you will be enjoying and then getting into the water. Either it can be Marina or Besant Nagar or wherever it may be. Wave started coming and then breaking on the coast. That's what we call it as a wave. Tides are another phenomena of the ocean which you cannot really see, but I will show you some pictures what is meant by tide. Currents are nothing but these are all the movement of water mass, like how when river is flowing from upstream to downstream. The similar way we have a water mass moving within the ocean also, in different directions depending upon the monsoon and then various other phenomena. We also know very well for the extreme events like this cyclone and tsunami. Cyclone is not new to the Chennai coast, and similarly in 2004 we had a massive tsunami which was hit, and then many parts of the Chennai, especially in the South Tamil Nadu and Nagapattinam, got affected by the tsunami. The other one which is very important for all of us to know about geology is sediment and beach. You know all about dams. Earlier there were no dams, so because of that, what is to happen is whatever sediments are eroded from the upstream areas, it is to come to the coast and then it get dispersed along the coastal areas. That's how we had a beautiful deltas called many of the places, either it can be Vellar Delta or even Nagapattinam or even north if you go for Godavari and Krishna or Mahanadi on the northern portion of the east coast of India. Since we had obstruction of dams and then many land use changes along the upstream areas, the sediment which is coming to the coast is reduced. As a result, you know very well that when there is no sediment, we have a downstream impact along the coastal area. So I will talk a little bit about issues related to erosion and flooding. Flooding, you need not have to, you might have seen physically 2005 Chennai flood, and then after that also we have a moderate floods here and there upstream. But it is not strange that we are going to get such kind of events in the future. So we have to be prepared ourselves for the flooding. Then climate change, its impact on the coast. Methods to study ocean and coastal process. Basically, there are various techniques which you use to study ocean and coastal process. One is the satellite imageries. You may be knowing about that when you open the Google, all this information is there on the satellite. So nowadays, our life has become very simple to get the information through the satellite. Then we talk a little bit about numerical modeling. Suppose if you see your fluid mechanics in the third year or second year, end or third year, depending upon your course curriculum, we talk something about continuity and momentum equations and also laminar, turbulent flows and all the related things. But earlier we used to use the equations called analytical equations, but later on this has been further improved in terms of increase in the computational power and then also on the technology. We use the technique called numerical modeling. It is also called as a computational modeling to simulate many things and visualize the what phenomena which is happening along the coast. So last I will tell you about little bit of management scheme, what need to be done for the coastal erosion, even flooding under the climate change. If you look at our coast, this is the simple picture which shows about that. I will move along my mouse. When you go along the coast, you will see the beach. You also know a river which is normally known to many of the people, but there is a term called estuary. What is the estuary is, what we classify estuary is, there is a water of sea which will go into the river and then come back up to the certain distance, not up to the full extent, depending upon the dynamics of the estuary. If you see Vellar estuary, the salt water will go up to 14 kilometers into the estuary. That is called as a, you call it as a river. Similarly, earlier Kuvam and Adyar, we used to have a seawater penetrating into the river almost up to distance of 10 to 15 kilometers. But there are a lot of changes along the coastline. Now it is not going up to that extent. Next one is the cliff. If you see in Kerala and Goa and many places, there is a vertical formation of the landform which is naturally formed as a cliff. Headlands, if you go to Goa or in Karnataka, many places, these are all the hilly projections which comes into the sea, which is called as a headland. We also have a beautiful cave, arch and stack and then sea. I will show you these pictures how it looks further. When you see along the east coast, what we call it as a landform, just look at in Gulf of Kutch, where we have a salt marsh. This is a plain water body where the water enters into the land of kilometers and kilometers, and again the water goes back to the sea. But further, if you go down, we have in Gulf of Kutch, they call it as a mudflats. This will be completely muddy in environment, and then we walk some other time that soil is very loose in this area. This is what I was calling about bay or headland. This is called as a headland, and this is the right hand side. What you are seeing is a bay. On the top side also, you see bay. I think when you go to the tourist places, you may be enjoying this kind of natural landforms which was formed over a period of time, and then that is a place for recreation and also for the ecosystem to survive on the top. Then coming to the cliffs which I have given here, at one is at Varkala and other one is along the Goan coast. They are the vertical landforms which comes along the coastline. But now many of the cliffs are getting eroded due to the sea action as well as land water which is coming on the top, and then slowly soil is getting loose, and then this entire soil mass is getting eroded for the many parts of the coast. Basically, these cliffs are made up of laterite soil. If you see in Kerala or in Goa or in Maharashtra, these cliffs can be widely seen at many parts of the coast. Other one is a barrier island. Suppose naturally formed volcanic islands in the Lakshadweep group of islands. If you see Maldives or even Mauritius, all the places, people will be showing good pictures about that. On one side, we have a beautiful lagoon, and other side, we'll have a open sea which is coming to the picture. These beautiful lagoons are all made up of volcanic formations, and then water depth in this area is maximum 3 meters, not more than that. That's why we used to take all this motor boats and enjoy on the other side for that. Then coming to the lake, you know very well Pulikat Lake, which is one of the best place for the birds to come and then nest, and then it gives a lot of importance to the ecosystem on other areas. And similarly, I was talking about the Vellore estuary, which is near the Kadalur. Once upon a time, it was a beautiful estuary, and then there are a forest called mangrove forest. If you people can visit there, it is a beautiful place where really it is a good tourist destination for them. Other part of landform is called as a beach cups, which can be seen in the Pulikat Lake and adjacent areas. These are all the natural landforms which was formed by the oceanic process as well as river line process. We also see some places where it is called as the caves and arches, especially when you go a little bit on the northern part of the India, you can see such kind of cave formations along the coastline. Sand dunes, which is very common in Tamil Nadu. If you go to Cheyyur or even south the line, especially where you have Muthukadu breakwaters and all, that place you can see a huge sand dunes which are formed over a period of time. But now due to climate change, the formation takes almost 5 to 10 years. But this loss of sand dunes will happen in a day or 2-3 days due to the cyclonic formations. So what do you mean by is that nature has created some of the good landforms with a long processes which has taken over a period of time, but the damage is happening due to climate change in a short time. So we are losing our beauty, and then our habitation is also subject to the threat because of the climate change. Similarly, when you go to the Orissa site, all these turtles which will come and nest, especially during the nesting season from January to February. Why they choose nesting in the January to February is that particular time your wave activity is slow. So these turtles, they will come for the breeding in that area, and then once they breed on the beach, the juveniles will slowly enter into the water and then they go back to the sea. So nature has given a good formation when these turtles have to come and when these turtles have to go. In fact, they are the guys who knows about how nature behaves over a period of time. We may do all this kind of measurements and all, but no turtle will do any measurement. They exactly know when they have to go for nesting and then when they have to go back to the sea. That is the nature gift what has been given by them. Similarly, when we have a sand spits, especially on the Pulikat, if you see on one side you have a lake and other side lighthouse. If someone who have traveled to the Pulikat, you can see a beautiful barrier island which was built over a period of time. This shows the barrier island which is inside the sea. And then if you see in the Ramanathapuram or Rameswaram, I think you might have seen many of the movies. These things were nicely pictured in the some of the movies for that. But these landforms are formed over a period of time for that. Similarly, when I talk about the delta, we have, whether it is Vellore, they have a Sethiyattapu dam on the top. If you see in the Godavari, when you cross the Godavari River, there is a barrage which you can see on the right hand side whenever trace goes on that other side for that. Due to formation or construction of this dam, that entire downstream area's morphology got changed. Even the same case with Vellore, this is what I call it as a mangroves which was formed over a period of time. But still the mangroves exist in the Pichavara. But climate change can have a serious implications on the some of these areas for that. But when you look at India's coast, there are very good resources along the coastal areas. This on the left hand side, if you see, this is the map of Indian coast. On east and west coast. On the west coast, we have Lakshadweep Islands. On the east coast, we have Andaman group of islands. They have ecologically sensitive areas called mangroves, tidal flats. You might have heard somewhere in the pictures and all, coral reefs. These are all the beautiful places where the fisheries resources will come, and then they do a lot of ecosystem resources are built on this coral reefs. For them. I have already shown about turtle breeding grounds, which is there in the Orissa. Why this ocean is important is when most of the people will depend on ocean for fisheries resources, especially people who live in the coastal areas, living the freshwater fishes, maximum fisheries resources all come from the ocean. And islands, we use it for the basically for the tourism and then recreation in the other side. So when we look at the coastline activities we have on the ports and harbors, fisheries aquaculture, coastal industry, power plants, and we also have a renewable energy. You might have seen ports and harbors, which is used for the shipping, and also many of the places we have built desalination plant. I think if you see south of the Nemili, where you have a desalination plant, entire Chennai is supplied by 100 ml desalination plant, which was located south of Chennai. So we have totally 9 coastal states and 4 union territories along the Indian coast. But when we look at the ocean floor, on the left hand side, I am seeing about the coast. Once you go inside the down, there will be a steep slope, and then after that you have an island which is coming into the picture. That is what I have shown you as a Lakshadweep group of islands or even Andaman group of islands. They are all volcanic formations and they are very active. In 2004, entire Andaman, some of the islands got submerged because of the tectonic activity in the other areas. But if you see in the beach, there are various landforms which can be defined. This is the standard classification of any coastal engineer which to do for that. If you go to the beach where the waves are breaking, and then you can see a white foam which is coming on the coast, that is called as a surf zone. That's why you always, whoever goes to the beach, they ask how long we can go into the sea. So sometimes we may feel that there are low waves, we can go into the beach, but it is not true. Sometimes if you have low waves, there will be high currents and which can drag you into the sea. So you need to have some kind of information whenever you get into the waters of the coastal areas. Waves are nothing but a rotation of the water mass or transformation of water mass from one area. Currents are, as I said, in the river, in the ocean also, there will be a movement of water mass from one place to another place. They are called as a current. If you see the bottom picture, I am showing here about the tide. What is meant by tide is, during the low tide, you can see all the ships are completely exposed. That means there is no water here. But the right hand side, when you started seeing there, you can see the water has already come and entered into this area. That means what will happen is, every 6 hours, there will be an increase in the water level and decrease in the water level. That means it takes almost 6 hours the water to rise. In Chennai, it rises almost 1.5 meters. That means it is almost like your window or door height of that extent. That much of height water will be rising in 6 hours. Another 6 hours the water will recede. But you may not see in Chennai and other places, but if you go into the port, you can see. This is what is called as the tide. This I will tell you how the tides are formed or why it has been formed. For them. When you look at the wave, you might have seen, suppose if you throw some stone into the water, you are getting ripples are generated from the wherever you throw the stone in the water mass. That is called as the waves. But these are all the small formation of the waves. But in the ocean, how these waves are formed? Nobody goes and throws some stone on the ocean. But what it does is, wind will come and hit forcefully on the ocean water. That will generate the waves. And from the generation area, it comes to the coastline. So the whatever waves which you are seeing when you stand at Marina or Besant Nagar beach, these waves are formed in the deep sea and then travel all the way in few kilometers. Sometimes it will be more than 100 to 200 kilometers and then it reaches the coast. Once it reaches the coast, it dissipates the energy and then breaks. So whatever energy which was given by the wind to the ocean, they are transformed into the waves and then that will come and then dissipate in the beach. So when you stand at the beach, these waves are breaking on the top. This shows the how the waveform looks like. This is called as a crest, this is called as a trough. This is a standard normal nomenclature which you may have studied in other place for that. anywhere will have a crust and trough. Between two crust or two troughs, it is called as the wavelength. And one crust to another crust, the time taken from one crust to another crust to move, that is called as a wave period, what we call it as a wave period. Now I will show you how it looks like further. This is the typical wave profile of a ocean wave inside the ocean water, and this is called as a wave crust. This is called as a wave trough, where the downward portion of that, half of the wave height is called as a wave amplitude. Between crust and trough, it is called as a wave height. Wavelength is, as I told you earlier, between the two crust, it is called as a wavelength. Between two crust to travel from one place to another place, that means if the crust has to travel from left to right by one to another place, that is called as the time period taken for one crust to travel from one place to another place. Wave frequency is nothing but 1 hour time period. This is called as the frequency, which is standard, which you have studied there further. Wave number, we call it as a 2 pi by L. That is, length is the, L is the wavelength, and 2 pi is 2 into what you call 180 degrees. It is almost 360 degrees, the same thing. Similarly, we call it as angular frequency. Ultimately, we come to the important parameter called wave celerity or wave speed. It is nothing but, you all know, the speed of any water mass or anything is related to distance over time, which you have studied in the plus 2 or even engineering. The length by wavelength by time is called as a wave period. That is what you are seeing. Especially during the cyclone, you see a longer wave period is coming and hitting on the coast, but normal time, the wave period will be less. It will be between 4 seconds to 10 seconds maximum. When the wave moves top of profile from one side to other side, but really the water mass will not move. Actually, what it happens is, the water mass will be revolving below the wave in circles. You can see here, this waveform, when it goes to this place, the water particle will compute one revolution on the top. That means, if a water particle completes one revolution, one crust will move from one place to another place. That's how wave is transformed from one place to other. So similarly, when you see in the ocean, these waves will move from the deep sea to the shallow water. Actually, the water particle will not move. You might have studied in the plus 2, when you generate a progressive wave or standing wave, the progressive wave is nothing but it is a transformation of the energy from one place to other place. But actual wave particle will not move. Actual wave particle move below the waveform. So when it comes from the deep sea to shallow water, the wavelength will slowly reduce. But you can see here, L1, L2, L3, L4, wavelength will be very high in the deep water. But once it comes to the shallow water, the wavelength will be reduced to the smaller length. So in the deep water, it will be around 150 meter will be wavelength. But when it comes to the shallow water, it will be around 25 to 50 meters. But on the other side, what will happen is, wave height will be very small in the deep water. But once it comes to the coastline, the wave height will be increasing very much. This is the reason why tsunami in the deep sea is very small, few centimeters, somewhere around 30 to 40 centimeters. But once it comes to the coastline, it can rise up to 3 to 6 meters, depending upon the where it is going to hit further. Especially in Nagapattinam, we have almost 6 meters height of the tsunami which was hitting on that. That is basically, whenever a wave started feeling the seabed, then it transforms into a different form, and then wavelength will decrease and wave height will increase. That's why the damage is very high when the wave comes to the coastline. Similarly, waves will come in sometimes in an inclined direction or plane direction, depending upon the bottom of the seabed, which can be seen here. Now, this is what I am showing about the tide. You can see the jetty here, and then top we have a structure. Now, there is no water in the left-hand side, but on right-hand side, you can see a huge water mass coming into the system. This is called as a tide. This is nothing but a rise and fall of the water level, which I told earlier. Every 6 hours, it will happen. Same thing is case with the left-hand side picture. Sometimes in the during the high tide, the boats will come into the system, and then they will stack on the other side. Again, after completion of repairs and all those things, they will be taking up when there is a high tide. So naturally, God has given a lot of gift to us in terms of rising the water level and all. But unfortunately, we used to disturb all those things for our greediness and then for our luxury. But these tides are basically generated by Earth and Moon interaction. It is called as a gravitational force. You might have seen in the Newton's gravitational law, m1 m2 by r square. R is nothing but a distance between the two gravitational bodies. m1 and m2 are the masses of the two things. So whenever there is attraction between the Moon and Earth, the water mass will bulge at one place. That place we call it as a high tide. That means there will be a rise in the water level due to the attraction of the Moon from the Earth surface. So this place we will have a high tide, and other place we will have a low tide. This is called as a tide. And similarly, when we have other side of the bulge, that place we will have the high tide for that. Then we have two bulges on both the sides. We will have a high tide, and this shows how the water mass is when Earth is rotating. Then tide will change over a period of time. This all depends upon the constitution of Sun, Moon, and Earth. That makes a lot of difference in the generation of tides or rise and fall of the water level in the sea. During the full moon, people always used to say, don't go to the sea. The reason is, this is very simple. During the full moon, you have a high waves and then high tides, which is coming to the picture. That's why fishermen exercise a lot of care when we are going during the full moon and no moon for that. This is what monthly changes what we get between. And also from within the 1 year, there will be change in the water level also over a period of time. During summer, autumn, and then winter and spring, there will be change in the water level depending upon the constitution of Sun and then Moon and Earth over a period of time. So annually the water levels also varies with total from January to December. This is a cycle what it happens annually with the system for that. Same is case with the climate. Earlier you might have seen, we are supposed to get, especially during southwest monsoon and northeast monsoon, rains. But now, because of the climate change, you don't see certain things happening exactly on the particular time. Randomly it happens. Sometimes you may have a complete failure of monsoon. During the northeast monsoon, you don't get the water problem, and then you have a serious problem of water. Or otherwise, you may get a more water with flooding and all those things on other side. So the climate change, what it does is, the natural system of the cycle has been changed completely because of the climate change, whether it can be increased in the carbon cycle or anything further. When we come to the tidal analysis, there is a way to analyze this water level. Suppose if it is a cyclic in nature, we call it as a Fourier transformation. If you have studied in M1 or M2 or M3, I really don't know which place they have studied for that. Fourier analysis is basically to divide a various component constituents of the tide. That means how much constituent is due to the Moon, how much is due to the Earth, how much is due to the other part. That can be decomposed using a fast Fourier transformation, and then you can predict these tides well in advance. That means waves and all those things we can forecast and then do only just 1 week in advance. But whereas tide, we can precisely predict and then say when there will be rise in the water level, when there will be fall in the water level. This shows about the globally how the tidal elevation will vary along the coast. Especially when you have a gulfs, there will be increased water level. This is also due to the resonance. You might have studied earlier in that resonance is nothing but whenever you have a narrow cross-sectional area, there is a modification of the standing wave that will result in formation of high tidal heights into the gulfs further. So this is the tidal map which is generated for the Indian coast. When you go from south to north, in the south it is zero. When you go to the north, in the east coast of India, it is around 3 meters. Similarly, when you go to the Mumbai, it is 3 meters. But inside the Gulf, it is quite high because of the resonance and then funnel effect of the Gulf which was there for the system. This is called as a tidal bore. It is nothing but a huge amount of wave which comes once in almost like a 7 days. The tidal bore will come and hit. We don't see much here, especially in Gulf of Kutch in Gujarat and then Sundarbans. We can see such kind of tidal bores coming often in many times. This is nothing but a storm surge. Whenever we have a cyclone, this is the kind of wave we get. Earlier, these storm surges were not severe, but now it has increased tremendously, and then you see lot of loss and then habitat degradation due to the storm surge further. The storm surges are basically happening due to the action of wind and pressure. They call it as a surge. I think you may be knowing for that. Whenever IMD forecast, they tell depression, first low pressure, then depression, deep depression, then finally it turns into the cyclone. As soon and when in the whenever there is a cyclone, you have eye and adjacent areas, there will be a huge wind field which is generating on the system further. If you look at the cyclone, when it crosses the landfall, one of the things which you notice is first you will have a landfall and then there will be a high wind activity on the coastal area. But again, there will be a calm portion for it. That is the place where the eye will turn, come and touch the coastline. When eye is touching the coast, you may not see eye wind field. But once the eye crosses, again the behind that there will be a second half of the circle which will come and hit. Again, you will see an increase in the wind field on that. That means whenever cyclone crosses the coast, first you see a high wind followed by no wind and again high wind. That is because eye is always located at the central portion for that. Storm surge, it starts in the deep sea and then comes and hits on the coastline and then it destroys many of the habitats and then coastal areas for that. This shows one of the measurements what we have done in near Pondicherry. You can see the wave height goes up to a height of 4.5 meters and then there is a increase in the water level by almost 1 meter due to the cyclonic, we call it as a storm surge. So whenever there is a cyclone, you should not go nearer to the beach or any places for that. You will have high waves associated with the storm surge. So these waves can be classified into various forms. It is too much to digest for you. Basically, what I wanted to indicate is the wave period can vary from 0.1 second up to 24 hours. Tsunami falls between somewhere between 5 minutes to 12 hours is the range where you have. When you have earthquake induced storms and anything, the wave period can vary between 5 minutes to 12 hours. That is why these are wave period is very high, and then you also have a large wavelength and large wave heights when it comes to this regime. Especially whenever you have this regime, I am showing between 5 minutes to 24 hours, the power of the wave, whether it can be tide or it can be storm surge, it can be tsunami, they are very significant and they are very high. So how tsunami is generated, you all know very well that when there is an earthquake, what is meant by earthquake is that you all know, you might have studied in the geology or many places for that. If there is a movement of earth surfaces, that will generate a lot of energy from the seabed to the ocean. That has to be transferred from the sea. It is transferred from the seabed to the ocean, and from ocean again tsunami is generated and then reaches to the sea for that. But when you look at the plate tectonics, I hope you have studied in the folds and faults gene for that. Ocean plate always lies on the bottom and then continental plate lies on the top. Whenever these two plates are moving under the continental drift theory, there is a energy which is developed between the two, this plate, between the two plates. Sometimes what happens is whenever there is increase in the stress, that will be released at one particular time. Because of that, there will be sudden subsidence and then you will have a tsunami generated at a particular place. Even especially for Andaman group of islands, what has happened is we don't have any earthquake for last 30 to 50 years. Now all the energy was accumulated between these two plates and it got released during 2004 Sumatra earthquake. Because of that, there is a depression of entire land mass on one side and then elevation of the land mass on the other side. That has caused a lot of havoc to the Andaman group of islands and that, but it is very common. So that's why we have to be very careful when we are living in Andaman group of islands. So tsunami, it starts from the deep ocean and it transfers back to the upper layer, and finally from the generation area it goes to the coast. So we call it as a generation propagation, and then finally run up is nothing but once it comes and hits the coastline, the water mass will enter into the land and then you see lot of havoc on the coastline further. As I told you earlier, tsunami is very small in height in the deep sea, but once it comes to the coastline, the wavelength will decrease and then wave height will increase, and then suddenly you see a huge destruction in the coastline part. That is what it has happened on the system further. So if you look at depth, when you have a 7000 meters, the wavelength will be order of 175 meter in terms of kilometers, it is this much further. The speed will be almost like our aeroplane speed. That means tsunami wave travels almost equivalent to our flight, what it travels in the air for that. But once it comes to the coastline, your wavelength is reduced to 10.6 meter, the speed also has reduced tremendously. But on the other side, the height will increase tremendously from 0.5 meters to almost 6 meters when it comes to the coastline. There is another phenomena called longshore sediment transport on the coastline. This I am showing about when the river comes and interacts with the ocean, how does this current move? This is the classic picture which can show from the top. Whenever you have a rainfall coming from the top, this arrow shows how the sediment will reach the coast and then how the sand is being transported from one place to the other. This has given rise to formation of beautiful landforms along the coastline further. So when we put obstructions here, naturally what it will happen is this particular sand will take its own course and then you will have a lot of downstream impacts when you have structures along the coastline further. This shows when I put any obstruction there, on the one side of the structure you will have a sand deposit, on the other side, since there is no sand movement to the northern side, that sand will be eroded. This is the classic case of Marina Beach. South of, I think right from the south of Chennai port, you say a beautiful Marina Beach, but if you go and see Raipuram, most of the area got eroded and then they have a lot of structures were built on the coast. This is because we have put obstruction of port on the particular area that has caused the erosion on the other side part. Now coastal issues, I think because of the climate change, many places you have a coastal erosion at all along the Indian coast, which is very common. Most of the roads got destroyed and railway tracks got destroyed and some of the buildings were lost. This is a combined effect of both natural as well as man-made action. But on the other side, if you start seeing for the coastal project, it can be Chennai or Calcutta or Mumbai, we have a huge floods which are happening along the urban cities, basically due to two reasons. Reason one is entire rainfall was coming up in the only short duration. Second one is you have many developments, you don't allow water to go into the sea because of our constructions, and then many of the culverts were closed along the most of the places. That is a common for even your college also. If you write on the left hand side, if you start seeing for there is a nalla called Ottiri Nalla, and that place also we have put lot of obstructions, and then it won't allow the water to go into the sea. That is why many places got flooded during the Chennai flood season further. And also many of the marshy lands we occupy and then we destroy the natural things. So whatever we do to solve this problem is we can always use remote sensing techniques and field measurements and numerical modeling. Remote sensing technique is nothing but we use the light reflectance from the satellite. That data will be collected and then that will be used to analyze the system further. So this data can be used in various applications. One is for the shoreline change studies. Even we can use for the disaster management. What are all the areas which was flooded along the coast that can be seen from the satellite imageries? What are coastal habitats, how they are changing over a period of time? And also we can use marine pollution and climate change related studies also we can do from the satellite imageries further. This shows the typical map of satellite imagery analysis for the Pulikat and Chilka Lake, how the Chilka Lake has changed over a period of time for that. Whenever we want to do a satellite data for that, we need to, because the satellite data comes as a raster image. What we meant by raster image is it doesn't have any coordinates. If you have to make it as a vector image is nothing but when you see the Google image, you can measure and then do all those things. What Google person has done is he has rectified the image with the lat long. That is why we could able to see your position precisely on the map. So if you have to do a map to be usable by you, so you need to rectify that. There are various kind of projections which can be used and then rectify the remote sensing image. Then after that, you can use whatever analysis you want to do for that. There are various techniques to do image enhancement in terms of clarity and then contrast and all those things. What you do for the camera, same thing can be done in the remote sensing data. And there are several techniques. If somebody want to work on remote sensing, they can come and work with our institute and then we will tell more on that. And then this is also one of the area which need to be taken by you. Some people, I think there is an anonymity, BTEC itself, they have a geospatial one course. But most of the people after civil engineering, I know you have one elective in the, in the final year or the end of the third year, elective called remote sensing. If you use this remote sensing, then you need to understand more about the remote sensing, what kind of applications it can be done. today entire world is using remote sensing because it is covers a larger area, and also you can get the temporal data. That means today to tomorrow, what is happening along the any part of the country, you can do for that. They use it for defense applications. Even in the Kargil war, people have used remote sensing data for precisely locating the targets at many places for that. So they have a wide application for the remote sensing to be used for that. Now, future world is going to be a geospatial world where you have many applications to be taken up with the remote sensing analysis. So always you can take up this course, and then this also had a better opportunity for the civil engineer to take up in the future. When we come to the coastal vulnerability, there are various forms of potential impact due to the climate change. One is due to the precipitation and runoff, and CO2 fixation as the biggest problem for that. Sea surface temperature is rising. Because of that, ice are melting and there is a rise in the sea level. And wind waves, which I have shown earlier, these things are being increasing over a period of time. There are evidences and data which shows that wave activity has increased significantly over a period of time. Similarly, storm intensity has also increased at many parts of the system. And this shows about the delta layer, how it is changing over a period of time, and then how can you use remote sensing data to precisely map most of the landforms along the coastline of the country. So when we go to the climate change impact study for that, you can do all these layers in the geographical information system in terms of a lot of information is collected. And finally, you can estimate what kind of impact which can have on the coast or any part due to climate change. This we call it as a coastal vulnerability index, but same thing can be done for the land also for that. This shows the coastal vulnerability index map, which was generated for the entire east coast of India. Basically, this map tells about what are all the areas which are subject to the impact due to the climate change and what need to be done in terms of mitigation, whether you have to increase mangrove plantation or vegetation, or what kind of protection which need to be taken up, which can be analyzed, and then this kind of map can be generated from the system for that. I think now we have almost 50 minutes. If it becomes too much, maybe I can talk some other time and then I can take questions at this stage. Dr. Vandana, what is your suggestion? Vandana, could you hear me?
Wonderful session, sir. It was very much interesting for all of us. Geetanjali, thank you, sir.
I think complete. What I can do is the rest of the part, preferably I can take later. I'll unshare my presentation.
Oh, sure, sir.
So now I think I have unshared. So if, otherwise, what happens is some of the theory, it becomes too much for them to understand.
Yes, sir. At this level, I think it will become too much for them. That's fine, sir. We'll again take up this. We can continue with this. Yeah.
If they have any doubts, I think I can...
Any queries from participants? Feel free to discuss with sir. Even faculty can raise any queries you have.
Any query is okay. You need not be on the subject or what kind of revenues you want. Anything is okay.
There are no queries, we can proceed with vote of thanks. Do you have any doubts, Geetanjali?
Yes, ma'am. Sir, I would like to know how much seawall construction will be effective in case of Chennai, sir, because we have a long span of Marina Beach, and how much it will be effective.
I didn't follow. Can you repeat the question?
Sir, how seawall construction can be effective for Chennai, sir, because we are more vulnerable to storm surges. We can construct a seawall across Marina Beach. So how much it will be effective, sir? So that's my query.
No, normally, you see, we should not go too much against the nature. Seawall is not at all a solution. Seawall is, what happens is, the seawalls are some of the hard structures we will do only where it is essential, the property cost is very high. But as far as possible, you do only nature-based solutions, which we have done in Pondicherry and other places for that. By doing that, what it will happen is, you will not transfer the problem to one place to other place. Suppose if you build any kind of fault structure, what it will happen is, it will protect the coast of that particular area, but it will have a negative impact on the other areas. So as much as possible, we should go by nature-based solution. That I will tell you, maybe I think when next class when I take, I will tell you, if you do a hard structure, what is going to happen on the adjacent area.
Sure,
yeah.
Sir. We're looking forward to it, sir. Ma'am, can we move on with the vote of
thanks? Please.
Now I request Akila to deliver the vote of thanks.
So I hope you all have a very good evening. It immense me pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks for the virtual event on shoreline management under climate change. I would like to thank the resource person of the day, Dr. M.V. Ramanamurthy sir, for enlightening us with his thoughts and knowledge on the subject. Thank you, sir, for the wonderful presentation. And also I would like to thank our head of the department, Dr. V. Vandana Devi ma'am, and faculty members and our audience for making this event a success. Once again, thank you all for the attention. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir, for sparing your time with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Have a great weekend. Thank you, sir. Thank you.